Welcome to this tutorial. My name is Patricia Balbastre from the Technical University of Valencia, and I'm going to present you this tutorial about static scheduling. Mixed criticality systems are becoming more important today due to its ability to integrate different applications of different levels of criticality, temporal constraints, and nature. And also to its ability to integrate these applications into different domains. One way to achieve the temporal and spatial isolation that need this kind of system is through virtualization techniques, for example using an hypervisor like Stratum. At the same time, computing platforms are moving from monocore to multicore, and this implies new challenge because these systems, the multicore system, are more complex. So the schedulability analysis and other things are more complex than in monocore systems. In a monocore partitioned architecture, we have typically three layers. The first layer is the computing platform, in this case with only one CPU. The second layer is the hypervisor, that is the element that achieves the temporal and spatial isolation between partitions. And the third layer is the partitions of the system. When we move to a multicore architecture, we have a similar layer, architecture composed of the three layers, but we have more than one CPU. In this case, we can have an operating system multicore or monocore, depending on if the partition have assigned one CPU or more than one CPU. The hypervisor manages the multicore system with the concept of the virtual CPU. This is an abstraction of the real CPU, and we can have as many virtual CPU as real existing cores. The operating system can be monocore or multicore, as we said before, and the allocation from the virtual CPUs to the real CPUs can be 1-to-1, several-to-1, or 1-to-several. This allocation must be done statically, that is, that it will be specified in a configuration file of the hypervisor. So in this tutorial we are going to talk about the steps we have to follow in order to generate the final configuration file, the static scheduling of this final configuration file. These steps are mainly four, and I am going to explain it in more detail in the next slides. In a first step, we have to determine the total number of cores of the system. In case that we have a fixed, this number of cores will be fixed by the computed platform, at least we have to be sure that the number of cores will be enough to allocate all the partition. If we have freedom to choose the number of cores, we will follow this step. We will divide the number of cores into two groups depending on the criticality levels. We will suppose that we have three criticality levels, a higher, medium, and low level. So we will divide the set of cores into two groups. The set H will be the set of cores that will allocate partition with the higher level of criticality. Meanwhile, the set L will be the cores that will allocate the low level criticality partitions. We will have a medium criticality level, that is, we will have partitions with this medium criticality level that will be allocated in the next step in the set H or in the set L, with a preference in the set H. To decide the number of cores for both sets, that is, the parameters NH and NL, we first have to calculate the total utilization of the system, that is, the utilization of the partition belonging to the high criticality level, medium criticality level, and low criticality level. The calculation is done following existing papers in the literature, It is clear that the higher the utilization, the higher the number of cores. In the literature, we have found that this relationship is to divide the utilization factor between a number that it is in the range between 0.48 and 0.60. We have choose a medium value that is 0.55. With these equations, we will find the number of cores for the higher criticality level partition and the low criticality level partition. The medium criticality level partition will be allocated to the set H or L, but we have to be sure that these medium partitions will be successfully allocated to one of these two sets. So we have a condition that must be fulfilled, that is this one, that the total utilization of the system multiplied by this factor will be lower than the total number of cores. In case that this condition is not fulfilled, we have to increase NH or NL in one unit and again repeat the equation. Once we have determined the number of cores, we have to allocate the partitions to the cores. As said before, we will apply the allocation to the high to the set of high criticality level cores and to the low, and the medium criticality level partitions will be allocated to the set of preferably high criticality level cores. If not, they will be allocated in the low level cores. To perform the allocation, we can use well-known bin packing algorithms such as first fit, best fit, or worst fit. It is assumed that the worst fit algorithm produces a more uniform distribution between cores, and it is usually the algorithm applied to allocate tasks to cores in a multi-core system. So we will use this algorithm, specifically the worst fit decreasing utilization. That is, that we will choose in a first step partition with the highest utilization, and we will choose this in this partition in decreasing utilization. As an example to see how this allocation works, we will have this example with 15 partitions. In this example, we have the three levels of criticality: 5 partition for a higher level, 3 partition for the medium, and 7 for the low. The utilizations of the partitions are shown in the table, grouped into these three levels. We have 3 cores for the high criticality level, 2 cores for the low criticality level, numbered from 0 to 4. So we will apply the worst fit decreasing utilization algorithm to the NH cores from C0 to C2. And this is the result. We will have the allocation of partition 1 to 5, that are the partitions of the high criticality level, and this is the resulting utilization of the cores once the allocation has been done. The same for the low level criticality for cores 3 and 4, and the resulting utilization. So the next step is to allocate the medium partitions to the cores belonging to the high criticality level. This is the situation before allocating. These are the same results than in the previous slide. And we will choose to allocate in the 3 cores of the higher criticality level. If not, we will have to allocate the medium partitions into the other ones. In this example, we have enough space to allocate the medium partition P6, 7, and 8 to the cores 1 and 2. And this is the result with the final utilization of the 5 cores. Once we have allocated all the partitions to the cores, the next step is to generate the scheduling. To do this, we have a tool that is concrete, explained in other tutorial, that will perform the scheduling algorithm and generate the chronogram and the final configuration file. In this tutorial, I am going to briefly explain the modifications and the main steps of this scheduling algorithm implemented in concrete. The scheduler is based on the well-known earliest deadline first, and to manage shared resources, we have chosen the stack resource protocol. This algorithm has been adapted to deal with our temporal model, that it is not based on periodic tasks, but is based on end-to-end flows. To model the interference between tasks in different cores, we have introduced a new parameter, that is the interference. This interference is the percentage in the worst case execution time of the task belong to partitions due to the execution of other tasks in other cores that may try to access simultaneously to the bus. So even if tasks execute in parallel in different cores, when they have to access to the bus, this will cause some delay to the task that cannot access the bus immediately. So this is modeled by the interference parameter. To see a simple example in the slide, we have three cores that execute each one task. So we have core 0, 1 and 2 and task 0, 1 and 2. In the slide we have the values of the computation times. Task 0 has 4 units of execution, 7 and 2 for the rest of the task. And the interference cost for task 0 to the rest of the tasks. So in the chronogram we can see that at the beginning, task 0 and 1 begin its execution simultaneously, and we have to take into account the interference in the execution of the task. So task 0, that has 4 units of execution, also suffers the interference of task 1, that is executing at the same time, and this task has 2 units of interference. So this interference is accounted for in the chronogram. In this case we have situated the interference at the beginning, it is the same situated at the final execution. The important is to consider that the execution time of the task is the sum of the worst case execution time and the interference. The same happens for the next task in core 1. This task has 7 execution, 7 units of computation time, and this gray square is the interference caused by task 0. In time 5, task 2 begins its execution, and this execution causes a 1 unit of interference in the rest of the task, that is depicted in the figure by these gray squares for task 1 and task 0. And the same happens with task 2. Task 2 suffers 3 units of interference, that is the interference of 2 units of task 1 and 1 unit of task 0. So, once the interference has been explained, I am going to explain how this interference is taken into account in the scheduling algorithm. So, basically, the scheduling algorithm based on EDF plus ASRP follows the typical steps of this algorithm, but we have to pre-calculate the interference to see if we have to make a context switch or not. That is, if we are executing a task in a certain instant of time, this task is TC, and we select the next running task according to priorities of EDF. So if this next running task is TH, we calculate the interference that this task will generate in the rest of the course if we are going to make this change in the execution task. If this interference is lower than the interference generated by the current task, then we change, and the next running task will be the task calculated by EDF priorities. If not, we maintain the current task in execution. So once all the steps have been performed, we are able to have the scheduling table, and the result is a list of temporal windows of the tasks in partitions for all the cores. The next step will be to generate the configuration file with this scheduling table. Here we have a simple example with the parameters of the partitions, with their tasks, the worst case execution time, and the interference. And this is an example of how the scheduling table will be in the configuration file. In this case, we only have one processor. If we have more than one processor, the tables will be put one following another. Concrete is able to generate the scheduling table in the configuration file, but also in a chronogram, so we can see the behavior of the task and the partitions. In this example, we have three CPUs, and we have the view of the global schedule for each CPU, but also we can view the execution chronogram of the end-to-end flows with deadlines, periods, and task instances belonging to each end-to-end flow. In this case, blue tasks belong to the same partitions, red tasks to the same partition, and green tasks to the same partition. So we can see how the CPU executes different partitions in different instants of time. So, as a conclusion, we have shown the main steps to perform the static scheduling of a multicore system in a mixed criticality system. So this is all. Thank you very much for your attention.